Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Mohan Boddu, and I work as a release engineer for Fedora. And this talk is about how we are doing mass rebuilds and mass branching in modularity. And this talk is for everyone who attended the last talk, so everyone, and who are trying converting their packages into modules and trying to create more modules. So before starting, I just wanted to ask, how many of you know how we do mass rebuilds and mass branching in regular RPMs? Okay, not many, probably one third even in this one. So, and how many of you know what actually mass rebuilds and mass branchings are for? Okay, some of you. So, anyway, I want to give a brief introduction about mass rebuilds and mass branching, what they are and how we do within RPMs, and then I will talk about how we are doing them in modularity. So mass rebuild is nothing but rebuilding all of the Fedora packages that there are, like all the active packages. So the reason that I do it is if there is a change in glibc, ABA change that affects indirectly or directly all the packages in the distribution. So we rebuild all those packages. And in the recent mass rebuild that we started like 2 weeks back, there were about 22,000 packages we rebuilt. And the way that we do mass rebuilds in RPM namespace is we create a separate site tag for this mass rebuild. And we use the site target to build all the packages. And once all the builds are done, we will merge them back into the rawhide tag. So the way that it is done right now is alphanumerical order, which is not great, because if you can do it in the, if you can depth solve and do it from there, probably there will be less FTBFS, which are failed to build from source. But currently we don't have that, so, oh well. I don't know how many people have attended the improving package experience and automation talk half an hour ago. So one of the things that they were talking about is rebuilding all the packages that depend on your build automatically. So if they do that, probably we don't have to do mass rebuilds, because glibc changed, ABA changed, let's do all the rebuilds and I don't have to do this part. Maybe. I don't know.
That would mean that every commit to glibc would be really expensive.
Depends. They might add a flag, like, right? You don't have to do rebuilds.
You don't have a guarantee that all the stuff is being rebuilt.
We are covering that by a rebuild pipeline.
Yes.
We will be doing that.
So I'm not saying I'm not saying it won't solve the problem, it might solve the problem. So mass branching. Mass branching is the one where we actually create new release from rawhide. So currently F31 is rawhide. August 13th is when we branch F31 from rawhide, which at that point rawhide becomes F32. So the way that we do it is we create all these branches in PDC, which was Product Definition Center. Merlin just talked about it. And then we add all the branches in Diskit for you guys, and add the tags and targets and stuff like that. And then the F31 branch, which we call at that point is a branched release, will be ready. And after a few months of testing and stuff like that, it will be released as an active release. So that's what mass branching is. Yeah.
Is it usually composed in the system?
Sorry?
Do you build compose after branching?
Yeah. So just like rawhide, we do nightly composers for branched releases as well.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a lot of people that are on follow branch releases.
But do you consider it as a part of mass branching?
Yes. We enable composers, yes.
Yeah.
So that is also part of mass branching itself. So Can anyone guess how we are doing mass rebuilds and mass branching in modularity? Except you. Okay, so let me reveal the surprise before we got there itself, or let me postpone it, actually. So in order to understand mass branching and mass rebuilding in modules, you need to understand stream expansion, which both the process depend on. So if anyone have built modules in Fedora, you might have known about stream expansion. Like, it will, when you use the build requires and requires streams, you can specify sort of regex kind of a thing. If you don't specify anything, it will just rebuild for all the active releases, or you can specify just particular releases that you want to build for, like 20, F31 and F30, so it will only build for those two releases. And you can say minus F30, which means it won't build for F30, but for all the other active releases. So it's really important to understand this one, because mass rebuild and mass branching are totally depend on this one. So mass rebuild and modularity. So there are two types of requirements. One is build time requirements, there is runtime requirements. So mass rebuilding modularity looks at build time requirements. So it will look at what platform does your the build time, what platform is the build time requirement for your module. So you will specify that you are in your module MD5, and then our tooling will look at this module MD5, does the stream expansion thing, and identifies if it is buildable for F30, or at this point F31 or not. So, and if you're doing for mass rebuild for the F31, so it will identify it, and it will rebuild for that platform. But here is the thing, it won't just rebuild for F31. It will build for all the releases, all the streams. And I will explain why and what's the problem with it later on. We use rebuild strategy as all, which means we are asking MBS to build all the packages that go in it as well, not just to reuse them, rebuild them all. And there are about 150 plus modules currently, which we need to rebuild. F31 mass rebuild needs to be started last week, but we hit some issues, so I have to start it sometime this week. Before going to the next slide. Okay, now back to that question that I asked. Can you guess how mass branching is happening in modularity? No, it does. Actually, there is not much of a difference between mass rebuilding in modules and mass branching in modules. We are just doing mass rebuilding again, but by adding a new platform, and which will be the new rawhide, and we are using a different rebuild strategy, because at that point of time, nothing is built for that new platform. So rebuild everything for that platform. For the old platforms, we don't care. If you're going to reuse the old stuff, that's fine.
But there is no branching on a disk level.
Binaries level. Yes, we just rebuild them. Yeah. And by adding the new platform, it will rebuild everything that depends upon the new platform. So the module stream expansion again plays a part here. If you specify nothing, that means it consider the new platform as an active platform and rebuild it. So the two problems that we talked about is we are rebuilding all the modules. For mass rebuild, we are rebuilding all the modules for all the streams and for all the for all the platforms. So the reason is it's hard to identify the dependency chain, which module stream is depending upon which module stream or for what platform. So unless this guy finds a solution for that, we have to rebuild everything. And the other thing we are doing is rebuild strategy all for mass rebuild. We are doing this because of the reason that I explained a few minutes back is let's say someone committed some changes to the diskette and they didn't build it. And this one will ensure that everything is built and then the module is built on top of it. So that's the reason why we are using rebuild strategy as all. So that's kind of how we are doing mass rebuilds and mass branching in modules. Questions? Yes. So the question is basically if there is a package that depends on a module and then it depends on another package, how do you do mass branching and mass rebuild? So the package part, which is an RPM level thing, which will be handled normally as it was doing, but when it comes to the modules, it will rebuild the package as well.
So after you rebuild the modules, you will rebuild packages which depend on that?
No. We don't have that dependency depth solving thing yet. So
initially the package will fail.
Yes.
And we'll ensure the file will work for you.
Yes.
So
which one?
The initial non-modular package.
Yes. On another module.
From a module that isn't built yet.
So.
But someone would need to trigger the otherwise it will just not be.
Well, I assume that not much will change. So. Engineering will go and build the non-modular packages in alphabetical order. Your package will fail because the dependency cannot be evenly satisfied. Mm-hmm. Then they will build the modules. It will fail, probably. Maybe not. You'll see. And then you will get bugs and you will test.
So there is a thing called FTBFS that we do, like a fail to build from source. We file bugs. So if during the mass rebuild process of RPMs, if your package build failed, we will file a ticket.
Yes. And then deal with it. But what if you do mass rebuild for packages, but you have still all non-rebuild modules?
Yeah.
And my package passes the mass rebuild.
Yes.
You don't have that because you don't inherit module to releases.
I mean, it might.
So there will be no modules. So you do it a mass rebuild of packages, everything which depends on modules fails. When you do mass rebuild of modules get into the repo.
Yes. Yes, I don't think we have a solution for that right now. Probably it's more like, hey, this bill failed. You go and deal with it, kind of a thing.
In case you have the parts which depend on each other, you cannot just go in one mass rebuild. So you do mass rebuild of first part, mass rebuild of second part, and then you need to redo the mass rebuild of first part again.
But again, we don't know where to start, right? It might be like a module depending on RPM and then depending on module.
Or in other order, but you actually need to do twice.
Like probably we have to do twice of each thing.
Yes, that's actually the point to do.
Sure. I'm not sure how many packages or modules will get affected by this. Again, one of the things is mass rebuild of modules, we rebuild everything. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter if the things got changed or not for all the streams and all the platforms. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, no. But that based upon how many modules are affecting or packages affecting for that, do we really have to go through this or just let the maintainers know about them?
It could be even worse because you can have packages which
and then
package dependent.
That's why I said we have
then
to do.
You have new module dependent on that package, which depends on the module, which depends on the package, and then you do must rebuild once rebuild
twice.
My concern is that you describe it as like two separate processes, mm-hmm. of package rebuild and module rebuild, but in the end it should be must rebuild of everything in Fedora, which then in sequence
one.
Of package and module rebuild because both
ones. Sure, but at the same time, even the normal RPMs, if I show you that one. Third point, we are doing alphanumeric order. Even if a package depending upon other package, even that might fail. So we don't have the tooling right now to go through the depth solving and like identify which have to be built first and then built on top of that.
So my suggestion would be that if you're looking into optimizing this order,
yes.
You shouldn't split it into packages and modules. You should build a common dependency graph of everything because it might be that the most effective way would be we build five packages, we build three modules, we build every five packages, again three modules, and so on. So not grouping them by type, but grouping them by dependency.
Yes.
Different system,
right? I actually, that's why I mentioned that it needs improvement. But sorry.
Have you encountered modules that need to be bootstrapped?
Modules that need, okay.
For example, a module that depends on itself.
Uh-huh.
Or a module that depends on its own version, like a different module that's its bootstrap version.
Yes. So the question is, have I encountered this module bootstrapping where a module depends on its own or a module depending upon its own thing but on a different stream? I have not. So, and again, it goes back to the same discussion. So we will try to rebuild it in the order that it sees it, and it might fail or it might not. No. So we don't do any check-ins. When we say mass rebuild, we rebuild everything.
But what does it mean? You go
every repository, everything.
I don't think that's true.
It is. Every active repository. We go into every active repository,
because
we rebuild everything.
No, because there are problems with packages, like one package was imported twice.
I mean, those things might fail. So that's why we file tickets.
Yeah, but I have tickets unresolved for 2 years, probably, that there was some... Like,
so
package was imported twice with different names,
mm-hmm.
but the spec file has the same name. And
because
if you went repository by repository, it would get rebuilt from the new repository, but that never happened. So I doubt you really do this, like, repository after repository.
Yeah, it is a repository after repository.
Well, active repositories. The repository is already that it won't build.
Yeah,
so if it was quite important, one of them was marked as not more part repository.
Yeah, but
if
the other was active, it's spec file, but this was never rebuilt.
Okay.
I mean,
so
it was trying to rebuild.
Probably it was so we use PDC to identify the active repositories or active packages. I've seen like a couple of instances where it doesn't have the data, probably when we created the PDC entries in it. So if it doesn't have the data, it thinks it is a retired package. So that's how that might have skipped it. So if you have seen it again, please create a ticket at Relange.
It was open for 2 years and it was closed and reopened. Because
in Bugzilla?
Are
you Relange? Or
Relange must be.
Okay. I think I need to look at it.
Yeah. So the question is actually how you identify the modules you want to rebuild and how you actually want to proceed. You are going to commit to each package
yes.
as you And what will be the message, like mass rebuild for Fedora 31? And
for modules?
And you will be rebuilding all the branches for all Fedoras and so on?
No. We only do it for rawhide. Only rawhide. But for modules, we rebuild for all the streams that are active.
But the streams are built for multiple Fedoras, like for other.
That's what I just said. Like we rebuild all modules, all the streams, all the active streams, all the modules for all the active releases. That was one of the problems because we are not able to identify the dependency chain of what module stream depending upon what other module stream on which was built on top of a different platform than. Yeah, we do commits.
You are not able to.
When you say.
There's no naming convention for branches and so on, and you are going to commit somewhere probably randomly and mistakenly.
No. We do commits. I think the commit might say like a mass rebuild for Fedora F31 or F30, like depending upon what release we are rebuilding it for. But it for modularity, we do an empty commit in the district. Yes.
You keep referring to the active module streams. How do you determine which PDC. Streams?
We use PDC to identify.
PDC, now, is it based on the EOL? Or?
Yeah, which are the EOL data. So the question is, how do we identify what are the active streams and what are the active modules? We use PDC, which stores all the EOL data, and based upon that, we identify what to build and what not to build. Yeah.
I would say module stream then get retired.
When you say retired, I don't think there is a direct way to do it. Like how you retire packages, like fed package retire. I don't think there is one for modules. You have to create a relish ticket, and we will update the PDC entry for that, saying like
there's
today is the retired.
There's definitely a relish ticket. But
yeah. But we never got
that
module. Yeah.
Yeah.
Any more questions? Okay. Thank you.